Well, good evening, everybody, and I think it's a great honour to have this, actually, this baton. I don't quite know what you think I can do with it in a few minutes, but if anybody is out of line, look out. But, you know, it's very interesting. Yes, I was 80, and that, of course, qualifies you as an elder in some respects, but I don't think all 80-year-olds necessarily qualify. And what's interesting to me, and I was thinking about it when I was thinking about what I'd say tonight, is that when I was a child, quite a small child, I always thought I'm going to be, when I'm an old lady, I'm going to sit under a tree and have children come and talk to me and I'm going to tell them stories. You didn't know that, but it's true. I don't think I've ever written it, but it's absolutely true. And so it's sort of like full cycle. Here I am with the baton, and I'm certainly going to be talking to children. I don't need the baton for that. So thank you, Chris, and thank you, Kathy, and thank you to Di, because without a wife, I probably wouldn't be staying with you, would I? So, and Andy, I never saw where you are, but you're up there somewhere, there you are. And Mary Lewis, or Mouse, is along at the end there. She's my left hand, right hand, and you know, helps me get around the world this crazy 300 plus days a year. I think that, you know, looking back over a life, there are various people and various events that help to shape you into who you are, and perhaps help you to have the message that I feel I have to share with people now as I'm 80, and I have been sharing it for some time. And first of all, I was born innately loving animals. That was just there. People say, what triggered your love of animals? I don't know of anything, and everybody who knew me as a child, they're all dead now, of course, but they all say that right from the beginning, I loved all kinds of animals, creepy crawlies and birds, and we had a dog and we had a cat. We lived in London, so there wasn't too much scope there, but I loved all animals. And I had a wonderful mother, and this is very important, because she supported all my love of animals. And she didn't get mad at me when I disappeared for 4 hours, and then she found me just as she'd called the police, all excited, because we were staying in the country, and I had been given a job of collecting the hen's eggs, and I kept asking everybody, but where does the egg come out of the hen? Where's a hole that big? I can't see one. And nobody told me, so I'd hidden in a hen house and waited. And if you actually look back on that story, you know, I went, first of all, saw a hen, and she was going into her little hen house, and I crawled after her. Big mistake, she flew out. And I was 4 and a half, but I remember so clearly thinking, this is a frightening place, no hen will come here, and going to wait in an empty hen house, and waiting and waiting and waiting, and the excitement of seeing this egg come out. And my mother could so easily have grabbed onto me and said, how dare you go off without telling us, don't you know how worried we've been, which would have killed the excitement. And instead she sat down to hear this wonderful story. And the little scientist, the curiosity, asking questions, not getting the answer, trying to find out for yourself, making a mistake, not giving up and learning patience, it was all there. And if I'd had a different kind of mother, that could have been crushed. So, big tribute to her. And she found books for me to read about animals, because she reckoned I'd learn to read quicker if I was reading about something I was fascinated in. And I found Dr. Doolittle when I was 8, and of course fell passionately in love with him. And I wanted a parrot because I wanted to be taught how to speak with the animals like he was. You must all know Dr. Doolittle. And in one story, he takes animals from a circus and releases them in Africa. And that set off my love of Africa. And then along comes Tarzan when I'm 10, and I fall passionately in love with this glorious lord of the jungle. And what does he do? He marries the wrong Jane. So anyway, I have to give credit to Hugh Lofting and Edgar Rice Burroughs, because that really was an important part of making me who I am. And so then I was dreaming of going to Africa, and everybody laughed at me. How would I get to Africa? World War II was raging, and girls didn't get to do that sort of thing, and we didn't have any money. So Jane, dream about something you can achieve. But my mother always said, if you really want something, you have to work hard and take advantage of opportunity and never give up. So I sort of drifted away from the Africa thing as time went on, but it was always in the back of my mind. And growing up in the war did two other things which I think are significant. And the first of those is not taking anything for granted. We had, some of you will remember, food rationing, and life wasn't easy. But, you know, so you don't take things for granted because you know how easy it is that it can all be gone. And the second thing that really affected me was the Holocaust, when the pictures came out of all those bodies and the naked skeletons waiting to be released. That had an enormous impact on me in understanding human nature. And the other thing, when I left school, I did a secretarial course because we couldn't afford university. And Mum said, well, maybe you can get a job in Africa, so wise she was. And the first job I had was actually with my aunt, who had she had a clinic for children with polio and Down syndrome and things like that. She was a physiotherapist, but more. And I went and took down the doctor's notes, and that made me feel every single day to be grateful for my health, never to take my health for granted. And that brings me to thank my father for his genetic contribution to me, because he was a motor car racer as a hobby. And he was, you know, he didn't need to eat much, didn't need to drink much, he could go all day without. And so he had a tough physique, which I suppose inherited from him. So that was the influences in my childhood. There were probably many more, but I think those are the main ones. And then working in London with documentary films, getting a letter from a school friend inviting me to spend a holiday in Kenya. Ah, that's the opportunity I've been waiting for. Everything comes back about my love of Africa. And I went home and I worked as a waitress. It was just after the war, and it was one of these, you know, hotels where you go for a week's holiday. And they came mostly from somewhere up in Yorkshire and places. They didn't have much cash. And of course, I made sure they knew I was saving up for Africa, which probably gave me slightly bigger tips, but they couldn't afford much. So it took a long time, but eventually I had money for this return fare by boat to Africa. The next person who came along who shaped my life in a huge way was Louis Leakey. I heard about him, and I was told, if you're interested in animals, you should meet Louis. So I went to the Natural History Museum, where he was curator. And I didn't go to ask for a job. I didn't think of it. I had a job in Nairobi. But he took me around and asked me all these questions about the animals. Well, okay, I'm just out from England and I haven't been to college, but I'd read books and more books. And I'd spent hours in the Natural History Museum in London. And so I could answer most of his questions. So he offered me a job just like that. He said, well, you know, my secretary assistant is leaving and I really think you'd be perfect. So, wow. And then he let me go with him. And this was another really, really meaningful experience to the now famous Olduvai Gorge, where so many famous human remains have been found. But back then, no human fossils had been found. It was only, you know, saber-toothed tigers and prehistoric giraffes and rhinos and hyenas and things like that, which is very exciting. But they weren't human. So Leakey used to go for 3 months in the summer with his wife, one other young English girl, and a few Kenyans. And he let me go. And that was my dream. That was the Africa I dreamed about, the Serengeti. All the animals were there then, the gazelle and the giraffe and the little dik-diks. And there were lions. And one evening, Gillian and I met a lion. And it followed us. It must have been three times the length of this room, which was a bit scary, but it was also exciting. And I truly believe that was the night when, round the campfire, Leakey decided to offer me the opportunity to study the chimpanzees. I would have studied any animal to be out in the bush, anything. Mice, birds of any sort, anything. And he offered chimpanzees. So it was a year to get the money. First of all, who was going to give money to this young girl from England with no degree? How stupid. But eventually a wealthy American businessman which is why I've always been so interested in philanthropy and trying to encourage it for those people who can afford it. And then having got the money, the British authorities in what was then Tanganyika, which was the old German East Africa, taken over by the Brits after World War I as a protectorate. And they said they wouldn't take responsibility for this girl. In the end, they said, but she must have a companion then. And so who volunteered to come for the first 4 months? We only had money for 6 months. And for the first 4 months, my mother came. I mean, amazing. So as I say, you know, I owe so much to her. And she boosted my morale in those early days when the chimpanzees ran away. And it was sad she left before the breakthrough observation, seeing the one chimp who'd begun to lose his fear, David Greybeard, not only picking pieces of grass stem and using them to fish for termites, but actually breaking off leafy twigs and stripping the leaves, which is the beginning of tool making. And back then we thought that humans and only humans used and made tools, and we were described as man the tool maker. So when I sent Louis Leakey a telegram, he made his now famous remark, which shouldn't be taken too literally, but it's been useful. He said, well, now we have to redefine man, redefine tool, or accept chimpanzees as humans. That was what brought the National Geographic into the picture. So although I was really worried the money'd run out, after the tool using, they came in and I didn't have to worry anymore. And I could settle down to really concentrate on finding out what I could, knowing that I now had time. I always knew I could get the chimpanzees to accept me if there was time. And it was really David Greybeard. He's another individual I have to acknowledge in this story of the influences in my life. And David Greybeard introduced me in a way to the other chimps in the forest, because they'd be ready to run as usual, and David was in the group perhaps, and he'd just sit calmly, and they'd look from him to me and back, and well, she can't be so frightening. And so gradually they let me come closer and began to trust me. And then I could really start to learn the details of their complex social life, this fusion fission where they travel around by themselves or in small groups, sometimes all meeting up for a tasty food, and learning about their postures and gestures that are so like ours, kissing, embracing, holding hands, what you can see if you watch these guys back here. And I'm glad this is nighttime or nobody'd be listening to me. But anyway, I'm sure some of you have watched them. And realizing that across the different parts of Africa, as more studies began, that in the different parts of Africa, chimpanzees have different tool using traditions, which we can call culture, because they're passed from one generation to the next through observation and imitation and practice. And it was sad to find that, like us, chimps have a dark side to their nature. They're capable of violence, brutality, and war, but they're also capable of love, compassion, and altruism. And I've always been really fascinated by the relationship between mothers and their offspring. Only very recently did we know who the fathers actually were, when we could use DNA profiling, collect up the fecal samples from all the chimps, have them all profiled, and then eventually you learn which male has sired which infant. But what I was observing was the relationship between the mother and her offspring and the brothers and sisters. And the child at 5 years, when a new baby is born, it's a 5-year spacing normally in the wild. The 5-year-old is still very emotionally dependent on the mother and travels with her and is dependent on her to learn the different food sources and so forth. And also very emotionally dependent on her, running to her if anything goes wrong. And so the bonds between mother and child get closer during that period, and the bonds start developing between the new baby and the older sibling. And then when the oldest child is 10 or 11 and the next baby is born, that older one is still returning, not as much, but still returning and spending time with mum and his little brothers and sisters. And this is where you see these close, affectionate, supportive bonds so often between these family members. Many stories. I could tell you stories for hours, but we don't have hours. because I do love telling stories. I think probably the Welsh blood in me, because the Welsh love singing and telling stories. But anyway, these affectionate bonds, these supportive bonds between family members extend beyond the family, just as they do with us. So that when a mother dies, if she has and leaves an infant, if the infant has an older brother or sister, it will be adopted by a female or a male, and males make very good caregivers. But in one case, when a little three-year-old lost his mother and we thought he would die, he was still suckling, although beginning to eat solids, and he was adopted by a 12-year-old non-related adolescent male who waited for him, carried him on his back, drew him into his nest at night, shared his food, protected him in times of social arousal, and saved his life without any question. So there we are. Violence and brutality on the one hand, love, caring, and altruism on the other. It's very clear there isn't a sharp line dividing us from them. And the way I came to understand this so vividly, the chimpanzees' different personalities and their emotions so like ours, was through all the collection of individuals that I studied, all the case histories. So all of them are part of who I am today and what I learned from them. And then I got to Cambridge University because Lewis Leakey said I had to have a degree and there wasn't time to mess with a BA, as he put it, and so I would have to go straight for a PhD. And a lot of students say, oh, how lucky you were, but you know, it wasn't lucky because I felt the other students resented me. I was coming in the back door. I hadn't had to do all the slog they'd had to do. Why was I so special? But even worse than that was the fact that these professors, of whom I was a bit scared, yeah, I'd have been scared of somebody like you, Aubrey, they told me I'd done everything wrong. It was a shock. I shouldn't have given the chimpanzees names. They should have had numbers. That was more scientific. And I couldn't talk about them having personalities. I couldn't talk about them having minds capable of any kind of thought or decision making. And I absolutely couldn't talk about them having emotions, because that was anthropomorphism of the worst kind. So there's me, naive, 26 by this time, nervous of the professors, not happy really at Cambridge. So why didn't I try and conform? And that brings me to the next important influence of my life, which actually is going back to my childhood. I had a wonderful teacher when I was a child who taught me, of course animals have personalities, minds, and feelings. And why shouldn't they have a name if you give each other names? Why shouldn't we have names? And that teacher was my dog, Rusty. And I'm sure many of you will agree, if you have a dog or a cat, a rabbit, a guinea pig, a horse, whatever, if you share your life in a meaningful way, you know the professors were wrong. And I think they didn't believe it themselves, but they didn't have the scientific tools back then to prove anything about personality, mind, or feeling. And they were very reductionist. They were trying to make ethology into a hard science back then. And so everything had to be very objective, and you mustn't have empathy with your subject, and all the things which, well, I couldn't live that way. And fortunately, and here's another important influence in making me who I am, I had a very remarkable ethologist as my supervisor, and that was Professor Robert Hind, who started off as my sternest critic. And then Hugo van Lawick, who is another important influence in my life, was sent by the Geographic to take film. And so Hugo's films, the Geographic films, took the chimps into the hearts and the living rooms of people, first in the US and then around the world. And when I showed Robert Hindo's films of Flo with infant Flint, and Mike rising to top position by using empty kerosene cans to enhance his status, because he was rather a small guy, and getting to the top and lasting for 6 years. And when he saw films of these kissing and hugging and calming each other and all the other amazing things that chimpanzees do, he completely changed. And he was the one who helped me to write up my results in such a way that I wouldn't be torn apart by my scientific peers. And I'll give you just one example. I mean, he must, poor Robert, I don't know how he dealt with me, because I was really naive. I knew nothing about science. I knew a lot about animals and animal behavior, but not how to write about it. And I'd written in my naive way that Flo had a new baby, and her elder daughter, five-year-old Fifi, was very protective of the baby and wanted to be close. And if other youngsters came up, she'd chase them away. And I said Fifi was jealous. And Robert said, well, you can't say that because you can't prove it. And I said, no, I can't. But, well, so what shall I say then? Because I'm sure she was jealous. And Robert Hines said something that's taken me through my entire scientific career, which I share with students everywhere. He said, Jane, I suggest you say, Fifi behaved in such a way that had she been a human child, we would say she was jealous. This is brilliant. And it can get you out of all kinds of difficulties when you're trying to show how human-like chimpanzees actually are. And of course, the thing is that biology now has really come along to support all these similarities in behavior that we observe, learning that the DNA of humans and chimpanzees differs by only around 98%, this little argument about exactly the percent, but we're very, very close. And that the composition of the blood and the immune system and the anatomy of the brain is so very similar. And we didn't know a lot of that back in 1960 when I began. So there we are. There is not a sharp line between us and the rest of the animal kingdom. And once you're prepared to admit that there is no such line, and that we have been very arrogant in thinking how totally different and special we are, that starts leading you to think of these other amazing animals with whom we share the planet. And you mentioned the elephants and the rhinos. I haven't studied either, but I've spent hours watching elephants, watching the relations between the mothers and the offspring, seeing the young males just beginning to feel their oats, and they just want to be always active, and they'll chase after birds, and they're very comical and wonderful to watch. And now they're being slaughtered. And most of the big conservation groups talk about saving the species. The species is becoming extinct, which is terrible. But they're never talking about the individual suffering that's inflicted on these groups of animals, and you leave little orphans who have the same capacity for grief as chimpanzees, who probably have the same capacity for grief in its rawest form as we have. And the rhinos, I don't know much about rhinos, but I learned a lot, and I can give you this later, but if you Google Mechi, M-E-C-H-I, the painting rhino, just Google that, what you see will amaze you. It's 1.5 minutes, but it's quite extraordinary. This rhino is a black rhino, and she's captive, of course. And when the keeper comes along with different pots of paint, she gets all excited, and there are these pieces of paper, and she puts her lip into the paint, and the keeper is holding the piece of paper, and she's just totally intent for 1.5 or more minutes making these marks with her lip. And of course, they've got these long prehensile lips. And I should have brought the painting with me, but it's at home, but they're beautiful. So anyway, understanding that there isn't a sharp line between us and the rest of the animals is disturbing in many ways when we think of the uses and abuses to which we put animals to every day. At any rate, I got my degree. I went back to Gombe. I could settle down and spend, you know, my time building up the research station. It was the idyllic life I dreamed of, plus, plus, plus. I could write books. I could analyze the data, which I love doing. And I could spend time out in the forest with the chimps, at the same time raise my own child. So it was the perfect life. So why am I not there? What happened? And what happened was another major influence in my life, probably the biggest so far. And it wasn't an individual, it was a conference. And it happened in 1986 in the US, and it was actually put together to celebrate the big book I wrote called Chimpanzees of Gombe, Patterns of Behavior, because that was the first really long book written on the behavior of one particular group of animals that had ever been done. And so we brought together the people studying chimpanzees across Africa and some in a non-invasive situation in captivity, like Andy, like your monkeys, very non-invasive, and where chimpanzees got to choose what they did. And it was really about behavior, this conference, but it was 4 days. We had one session on the situation across Africa as far as chimpanzee numbers were concerned. And it was shocking. Every single field site, forests were disappearing, chimpanzees were being caught in wire snares, the beginning of the bushmeat trade, surveys showed numbers dropping everywhere where they'd been done. And we also had a session on conditions in some captive situations. And there was secretly filmed footage from medical research labs where our closest relatives were in 5 foot by 5 foot cages with nothing in them except maybe a motor tire. And some of them in this film had been there for 30 years. Why? Because they're so like us. Because science thought it was okay to use them to find out about diseases and vaccines which wouldn't apply to other animals who are less like us. But at the same time refusing to admit the very obvious intellectual and emotional similarities, which is why they could be put in a 5 foot by 5 foot cage. And there are still some chimpanzees in 5 foot by 5 foot cages, and many other animals as well. At any rate, when I left that conference, I was conscious of making no decision, but I went to it as a scientist and I left as an activist. So from 1986 until now, I haven't been anywhere for more than 3 weeks at a time, except once when I'd torn the tendons in both feet, so I had to get better. That was a chimp, by the way, in a sanctuary, but anyway, never mind about that. He was a young one playing. It wasn't play for me, but it was for him. And so I don't know what I thought. I think I was mad. What did I think I could do to go out to Africa to do something about chimpanzee conservation? Wasn't that stupid? Well, I got the Geographic to fund a series of enlarged photographs on poster boards, just black and white, very, very simple, not like we would do today. And the oil company Conoco sponsored my travel, and I went round to chimp range states, to capital cities, and got the people on the ground, the NGOs, to try and put a little program together, starting Wildlife Awareness Weeks, which continue to this day, trying to meet as high up a person in government as I could, environment president if possible, and thanks to Geographic, there were a few presidents lined up. I think I went to 6 different African countries and started these Wildlife Awareness Weeks and certainly learned a great deal. And what I was learning was something different, not just about what was happening to the chimpanzees, not just what was happening to the environment and the forests, but also the problems that were faced by the African people. And this was a very important lesson to learn, because tremendous crippling poverty, hunger, disease, lack of education, all of these things. And so I reckoned that not all of these problems, but many of them, could be traced back to the old colonial days when people went into Africa and raped and raped and took and settled down and took control of the people. And when I say they took natural resources, that included people, the slave trade. A horrible, shocking time. But in some respects, some, but by no means all, of the big multinational corporations are doing very much the same, although not in quite such a blatant way. But in both cases, the people usually left poorer, while other people get richer. That's what took me on the lecture circuit in Europe and North America and then Asia and now more South Africa. It started with lecture tours to raise money to keep Gombe going. But then it became an awful lot more. And while I was traveling around, still going to Africa, I was finding an awful lot more out about what we're doing to this poor old planet, which most of you know. I mean, you know how we're poisoning the earth, the air, and the water. You know about the poisonous chemicals that we throw onto our food that we get when we buy what they call result of conventional agriculture. And when was it conventional? When did somebody decide that it was conventional to spray chemical poisons onto our food? I don't know. But I resent the use of the word conventional for using pesticides. At any rate, we know that the chemicals are washed down by the rain into the streams, into the rivers, into the sea. We also know that the forests and the oceans are the two great carbon sinks, the two great areas of environment which can trap CO2 from the atmosphere. And that was becoming increasingly important because our emissions, our industrial emissions, ever since the Industrial Revolution, were increasing, the so-called greenhouse gases. And the three of those gases that are influenced by us are CO2, methane gas, and I've forgotten the other one, oxygen, some kind of oxygen, oxygen nitrate, I think. And CO2, carbon, is by far the largest emission that we make. And as the oceans are absorbing more and more and more CO2 from the atmosphere, some of it is absorbed, is made use of by things like kelp forests and the grass meadows that are in the ocean, and all the rest is free floating in liquid form, and it's causing the ocean to get more and more acidic. And the more acidic it gets, the less CO2 it can absorb. And the forests, they're absorbing CO2. They use it for photosynthesis. It's sequestered by the leaves in the trees and also in the forest soils. And as more and more forest is destroyed, and particularly when it's burned, huge amounts of CO2 released into the atmosphere. And there's less trees left to absorb this extra amount of CO2. So with the ocean and the forest, the two greatest absorbers, this is the main reason for climate change. And Sir Nicholas Stern, when he released the first real detailed scientific report on climate change, which was something over 2,000 scientists from around the world, he came up with the conclusion that the cheapest and most efficient way of slowing down global warming is to conserve the forests. He didn't mention the ocean, I think he should have, but anyway. So these things were shocking to learn about. And I flew over Gombe in 1991, and I knew there was deforestation outside Gombe. But I wasn't prepared to see that the hills around this tiny jewel of a national park, rich and green looking down, was by then surrounded by completely bare hills where there had been forest. And looking down, it was obvious there were more people than the land could support. They were too poor to buy food from elsewhere. They were cutting down the trees in their desperate effort to grow food for themselves and their family, or to sell charcoal or something like that. And it came to me then, there is no way, while people living around Gombe are having such a difficult life, that we can even try to protect the chimpanzees. And so that led to our program, which I won't go into, but it's called Takari, or Take Care. And it's a very holistic program to improve the lives of the people and to help them grow more food by restoring fertility to the overused land, to help the water diverted in a clean way into the villages so that the women didn't have to climb so far, to reforest the slopes of the steep mountains so that the terrible soil erosion was prevented and the stilted streams began to flow more freely again. And then I think better health facilities, better education was what they wanted, so we worked with the Tanzanian government to do that. And then I think the most key part of the program was microcredit opportunities for women, so that women could take out tiny loans for environmentally sustainable projects. And as the people began to trust us and realize the benefits of the Takari program, so they turned around and instead of resenting these white people wasting all this money on monkeys, now they became our partners because they understood. And they understood the value, and the trees began to reappear. And they agreed to put a buffer around Gombe of their own village land as forest reserve. And the trees are already 30 foot high. So the chimpanzees have more forest potentially to go to than they had 10 years ago. Not as much as before when it was all forest, but more than 10 years ago. And this program went into other villages. It's in 52 now. And so trees are beginning to appear all over this once barren landscape. And down in the south, the still untouched, intact forest, which has more of the Tanzania's remaining chimpanzees than anywhere else. So we're using the same kind of program to work with the villagers there so that we protect that forest and we restore the forest around Gombe. And it's working. So we've replicated that into Uganda, into the Democratic Republic of Congo, into the Republic of Congo, and into Senegal. And so when people say, but how can you spend money on chimps when they're starving people? If we were just to spend money on chimps, it wouldn't work. And we try to get partners who help us with the people part of it. And of course, underlying all of this and all of these problems is the growing numbers of people on this planet. And for a long time, this was politically sensitive. You wouldn't catch the big environmental groups talking about overpopulation. But I found that when I talk to people, if you set it out as a very, in a very clear way, that we have this amount of land and it has that amount of resources, and they are not infinite, they're finite, when they're gone, there's nothing. And if you explain to Africans that if you have 10 children, that this resource will only last for 3 years, but if you have two, it'll last forever. So they understand, and we have a family planning program, which will please you, Aubrey, and we've been congratulated by the Tanzanian government for taking the lead in family planning in that part of Tanzania. We're spreading that too to these other countries. And so that part of it's working, but what about the rest of Africa? Well, the rest of Africa with the bushmeat trade, the commercial hunting of wild animals for food is absolutely destroying animal populations. And a lot of it's made possible because the big logging companies and the mining companies make roads deep into the forest so that hunters have access where they didn't before. And there are many other problems across Africa, but that's enough. You get the picture. And the problems that we've inflicted in our own societies, the problems of discrimination, the kind of things that go on in Britain, in the UK, the terrible slavery that's going on, the women coming over and being sold into prostitution. This woman who's being sent back to Nigeria, begging and begging not to be sent because her two little girls will have female genital mutilation practiced on them. And the Home Office saying, sorry, we don't care, you have to go. People are fighting for her. So if you get a chance to sign something, please sign it. At any rate, it's not surprising really that I meet so many young people who just feel hopeless, some depressed, some apathetic, some violent and angry. And I talked to them and they said, well, we feel like this because we feel you're compromising our future and there's nothing we can do about it. Look at a little child today. If I'm 80, I look at a small child today and I think how we've harmed this planet in the years of my life. But there are younger people here, and you can think exactly the same, because the rate of destruction is increasing. We get the rapacious Asian markets coming in, and they want natural resources to fuel their rapidly growing economies, just as we did. They're not doing worse than us, but there's less left to rape, and there are more of them, and they have better technology, so they can do it more efficiently. So it's a very tough situation and it's getting worse. But is it too late? Many, many, many biologists and scientists will tell you it's too late. I've heard them. I talked to a young woman this morning who's been interviewing well-known scientists, and she said, I come away from all those interviews really depressed because they say, well, it's no good really. But there are a handful of scientists who feel there's a window of time, and I don't pretend to be qualified to actually be able to tell you if there's a window of time, but I'm going to believe there is a window of time in which at least we can slow things down. But, or if, or whatever you want to say, it isn't just going to happen. It's only going to happen if we can change attitudes fast enough. And what I find wherever I go is there is a growing awareness. I mean, most people now accept that there's something called climate change. They've seen these strange weather patterns that put the south of England underwater, the worst typhoon to ever hit land that destroyed the Philippines, the worst coldest winter they've ever had on the east coast of the United States with millions of people stranded because of aircraft not being able to fly and so on. So we know about that. But understanding the position, unless you change your behavior, is no point. And the reason that people don't change their behavior, I firmly believe, is because they think there's nothing they can do about it. That's why. What can I do? I'm one person. These are huge global problems. It's the big corporations, it's the governments. But you know, every single one of us as an individual makes a difference on this planet every single day. And we may feel it doesn't make a difference what we choose to do, what little choices we make. And it doesn't if it's just me, but it isn't just me. We have to get billions of people making ethical choices, thinking about the consequences of what they buy, what they wear, how they get from A to B. So how do we do that? I started a program which Chris mentioned, Roots and Shoots, in 1991. Started with 12 high school students in Tanzania. It's now, as Chris said, in 136 countries. Most are very small island nation, but still it's there. And many of the countries, there aren't many groups, but they're there. And the seeds are planted. And we have 150,000 groups, active groups, in these countries. And a group can be a whole school, or it can be two individuals. But the average, probably 30, 40, something like that. We had a group of children this morning, Roots and Shoots, from which school was it?
St. George's.
And there were five of them. And they were so articulate, they were so passionate, what they are doing to make a difference and how angry they are and how upset they are and how they're not going to sit and watch their television. The important thing they told me is to get out and do it, so then you really get to see and you feel that you're making a difference. And then they said, that acts like magic because other people want to join in, and then you find you have fun as well. So when you think 150,000 groups around the world, and it's all ages. We have even a few preschoolers, a lot of kindergarten, but then all the other ages, very strong in university, very powerful in universities, particularly in China. In China, the university students are starting Roots and Shoots groups in the primary schools and some of the secondary schools. They're working with immigrants from the country into the towns. They're doing a fantastic job in China. But other universities are building up the groups as well. And so, you know, how do I have hope? Why do I have hope? Because everywhere I go in the world, there are these shining eyes wanting to tell Dr. Jane what they've been doing to make the world a better place. And so that is one great reason for hope. And then we come to this brain we have up here. We talked a lot about similarities between humans and chimps, but clearly we're different. And although chimpanzees are capable of much more intelligent behavior, and I'm sure Andy could come and give a whole speech on this, but I'm sorry you don't have the chance tonight. So could I, for that matter. But, you know, they can do things with computers that nobody ever dreamed they could do. They can memorize numbers, other primates as well. But even the brightest chimp, who actually is one in Japan right now, but if you compare him with the creature that actually created a rocket that went up to the Mars, the red planet, millions, hundreds of millions of miles away, and out came a little robot. I think it was 5-6 years ago, that robot is still crawling about over the surface of the red planet, sending back photos for us to see. And so how is it that this creature with this incredibly developed intellect, which I think is the biggest difference between us and the other animals, probably because we developed this kind of speech using words so that we could discuss the past, plan the future, discuss problems. How is it that we're destroying our planet? What has gone wrong? And I think what has gone wrong is this crazy materialistic consumer society. We have totally made a disconnect between the clever brain and the human heart. And it's when the human brain and the human heart are connected that you get wisdom coming in. And the elders that we're talking about, the elders made decisions for their tribe based on how does this decision affect our people generations ahead. We don't do that much anymore. It's how does it affect the next shareholders meeting? How does it affect the bottom line? How does it affect me now in my next political campaign or whatever? And so if there's a disconnect between the head and the heart, I believe that our true human potential will only be realized when the head and the heart can work in harmony. So the human brain is beginning to turn its attention to the problems that face us. Technology exists. I'm told that there is technology out there for green energy and other things like that, which if the government would get behind it, instead of staying loyal to the big lobbies of the oil companies and the mining companies, because that's who gives them their money, but if they would subsidize these other new technologies, we could get away from our terrible reliance on fossil fuels, which is really killing off the planet bit by bit. And so as we get these technologies and as people become more aware, and while we cannot wait for young children to grow up, I don't think, but what do young children do as well as projects to benefit the environment, to benefit animals, including human animals, roots and shoots is the whole spectrum. They influence their parents. They're always influencing their parents. I meet parents all over the world, China and India and Japan and Africa, who say, well, I never used to recycle, but the kids make me. Or I used to always take the car, but now I sometimes walk. Now I take my bicycle. The children are influencing their parents, which is another great reason for hope. And then you've got the resilience of nature. And I already gave an example. Around Gombe, trees, the weather ground was bare. The seeds have maintained a grip on life as they lay there in this over-farmed land. And probably some root systems under the ground sprang back to life. And the resilience of nature in that part of the tropics is such that we got these 20, even 30-foot high trees in 10 years. And I'm sure you all know places that we destroyed that can be resurrected and brought back to life. And they may not be exactly as they were, but they can once again support plant and animal life. And basically, in the end, they're going to have to support human life as well. And animals? Animals on the brink of extinction have been rescued. The last book I wrote, and I encourage you to read it because it is utterly inspirational, because every chapter is about a species of animal that would not be with us but for a group of amazing people who decided against all sorts of opposition. Oh, you can't do it. Oh, it's too expensive. It won't work. But they've done it. And although that animal or plant or whatever it is, we can't guarantee it'll survive into the future. It wouldn't be here now but for them. And some of these rescued creatures are really prospering. And my favorite story is about the black robin of New Zealand. And this bird was loved by a very, very wonderful ethologist who's unfortunately died since I started the book. But Don Merton was studying black robins, and he noticed the numbers were getting less. It was in New Zealand, where the birds have no flight fear mechanism because there weren't any predators. And he thought, oh, their numbers are going because we've introduced cats and rats. And everybody laughed at him and said, that can't make any difference. But finally, the government said, all right, well, you can catch, but you can't catch more than 30. At that point, there were only 20 birds left. So he caught the 20 birds and he put them on this little offshore island where there were no cats or rats. And they went back in the spring when the weather permitted them to, and they found one breeding female who had an old mate who turned out to be infertile. And the rest were young, one infertile female and some young males. So this female, I mean, you say it's hopeless by then, right? Fertile female, one with an infertile mate, and the other female's infertile, so where do you go? She dumped the old guy. He'd never been seen before, and she took a young male. And now this is common, but Don took a risk because he'd never been done in the wild. When they made their nest, it was called blue and yellow because of their leg bands, they made a nest and he destroyed it. And as he hoped, she made another nest. And he destroyed that when she laid eggs. And the eggs were put in the nests of other birds. And then when they hatched, she was sitting on her third lot of eggs. And he brought the first babies back so that they could learn to be black robins. And she accepted them. And her poor mate, Yellow, had to rush around getting food. And then the next lot hatched. And he took them back and he said, she looked up at me as if to say, what next? And he said, it's all right, my darling, we're going to help you. So he and his companions went round catching bugs to feed these birds. Anyway, there are something like 500 black robins today. And although they're genetically identical, they've been put on five different islands, so there'll be hopefully some genetic drift and they won't all be killed off by one disease at one time. So resilience of nature. And the indomitable human spirit, the people who tackle impossible tasks and won't give up and inspire others along the way. So I have two little people here. And I should have introduced Cow before, because actually she comes earlier in the story, but I'm going to introduce her now anyway, because I think it's very important. She was given to me as a kind of silly little gift when I was in the US in what they call the Dairy State, Wisconsin, and I was going to give her to a deserving child. And then I thought, no, she's going to be my spokesperson for the millions, billions of abused farm animals in factory farms. And I don't know if any of you have been into an abattoir. I don't know if any of you have seen a factory farm or what goes on in it. If you have, I'm sure you couldn't sleep for days afterwards. But there are some people who say, oh, well, it doesn't matter because we breed them for food. Well, we breed them for food. Does that mean they have no sensibilities? Does that mean they don't feel pain and fear? And if you don't care about animals feeling pain and fear, just think that as more and more people want to eat more and more meat, as middle classes grow and get more money around the world, billions of animals are being bred and people want cheap food, cheap meat. So we have to do it in the cheapest possible way, which gives rise not only to these factory farms, but acres and acres and acres of forest are destroyed every year to grow grain or to graze cattle or goats. And that is, as we've seen, releasing CO2 into the air. Methane gas is even more strong than CO2 as a greenhouse gas. And when cows, particularly cows, everybody, including us, but when you chew up vegetation, you know, it's sort of in here and out there. And that is adding hugely to the greenhouse gases. And if you don't care about that, what about the fact that to keep these poor things alive, they have to be routinely fed antibiotics, just to keep them alive. So the antibiotics get out in the environment and the bacteria build up resistance, and people have already died from a cut on the finger. And my last, Mr. H, given to me by a man who went blind at 21, decided to be a magician, was told it was impossible, said he could try. Children don't know he's blind. At the end of the show, he tells them, he says, things may go wrong in your life because we never know. But if they do, don't give up. There's always a way forward. And he climbs mountains, he's climbed Mount Kilimanjaro. He does skydiving. I mean, personally, I think it's insane to jump out of a plane when you can see, but to jump out into a black space. I mean, it's the height of insanity, anyway. But that's the kind of, and he thought he was giving me a stuffed chimp 26 years ago for my birthday. And I made him hold the tail. I said, Gary, I know you can't see this, but you can feel it. He said, oh, never mind. Take him where you go, and you know I'm with you in spirit. So he's traveled with me through 60 countries, and he's probably been touched by 4 million people, because I say the inspiration rubs off. So that's the message I have as an elder, to understand that each one of us makes a difference, and to understand that the problems we face are interrelated, and to have hope. Because if you don't have hope, you will do nothing. And if we all do something, and we all persuade others to do something, then we have a chance. And while there's a chance, we have to do our bit. And if we don't, I don't know how we'll be judged. We've got to save the elephants. We've got to save the rhinos. We have our Roots and Shoots groups in China working so hard. Stop buying and the killing stops. So there is hope. Things are changing, but we all have to do our bit and remember that every day we make a difference. So I think my last task tonight, or is this after the questions, or is it now? After the questions, so I mean I have it a little bit longer. Yes. All right, okay, well I should make use of it now then. Yes. I'm going to have to give it away just as I have it. Anyway, so questions?
Jane, thank you. Thank you. That was just. I'm looking for questions, so I'd just like to invite any questions from the audience. Jane, I don't think you need me really. Carry on.
Oh, one at the back.
I hope you heard that recently, I think it was a gentleman who pays me like $500,000 to shoot a very old male rhino.
Yes.
I just got to look, and I was just wondering what your take on it is.
I think it's absolutely obscene. Absolutely obscene. He could have paid that amount of money to save the rhino and given it to the national park. If he had that amount of money to go and shoot an animal, to stick its head on the wall, it's utterly obscene. And what sort of message does that give to the people we're trying to stop poaching rhinos? They'll just say, oh, well, he wants to make money from the horn. Maybe he did. We don't know, do we? He's horrible enough to have even done that.
Who would like to ask next?
Gosh, if you were 10-year-olds, every hand would be up.
Funny. You just happened to have one, right?
Oh, yes.
10-year-old.
There we go.
Eric.
If you had a favorite chimp, who would it be?
David Greybeard. And after David Greybeard, old Flo, she taught me so much about mothers. Yeah. And the favorite one alive today, unfortunately, my favorite one just died about a month ago, and that was Freud. It's very sad.
Anyone else with a question for Jane?
Yes?
It's so nice to have you here at Edinburgh Zoo. What was your favorite exhibit so far in Edinburgh Zoo?
Obviously this one. I don't know, Andy, yours isn't an exhibit, is it? It's a research centre. But if it was an exhibit, and people go through, so that's fantastic. And I guess most people wouldn't realise it wasn't an exhibit, because it sort of is.
Yeah.
I mean, if the public can go through and watch, it is an exhibit. Whether you're exhibiting researchers taking notes or what you're exhibiting, and it's an exhibit.
Anyone else?
It was just a question about the work you were doing with the villagers, and I wondered if working with the women, because what I think is what you do is you allow people to arrive at the conclusion themselves, providing the conditions. And I wondered if these women if you found that women began to arrive at the thought that maybe they didn't want so many babies?
Well, basically, it wasn't the women who wanted them, it was the men. The reason we concentrate on the women is because all around the world it's been found that as women's education improves and they become empowered, family size tends to drop. All around the world that's been found. And you'd be amazed to hear, if you know Africans at all, which some of you may and some of you may not, that we had 11 men come and ask for vasectomies because they realized they can't afford these children. See, culture cannot change fast like that. And the culture was big families, partly because so many babies died. So you have all these, you know, Bill Gates going and keeping lots and lots of children alive, but you've got to balance that with family planning. And growing more food will produce lots more babies unless you tie it in with family planning. So the first of the microcredit programs was Mohammed Yunus and the Grameen Bank. And the women there, they have to read a thing with 13 kind of conditions, which they don't have to promise to do, but they have to promise that they have read and understood it. And they are expected to try to have small family. And Bangladesh, the population's really dropped birth rate. Yeah.
Anyone else?
Oh, see, people are getting up courage.
When you're first starting out and, you know, you went out to Africa, how did you find the courage to do it? Because surely there were so many people you'd be leaving behind. So how did you find the courage to actually...
It wasn't courage at all. It was just that my dream come true. That's what I'd always wanted. When you're passionate about something, it's not courage. I just wanted to do it, and I felt at home in the forest, and I loved being there. Was I ever afraid? Of course, because you're a bit stupid if you hear a leopard nearby and you don't feel a little rush of adrenaline, or a buffalo about to charge. You need that adrenaline. That's what fear is really for, to give you the adrenaline that will help you climb a tree extra quickly or do something, whatever it is you have to do. And your question?
First went over to Africa, you obviously said you've met a lot, or tried to meet as high up a person in that government as possible. Did you always get a good response? Or was it a mixed reaction to what you were trying to...
No, I think, you know, it depends how you put things as to whether you get a good response. So in those first trips around with my little exhibit, they thought I was a bit crazy. But, you know, the geographic had penetrated by then, even into most parts of Africa. So that the politicians and the people working in NGOs and so forth, they'd heard about me. And so the sort of curiosity factor was very useful. Is she real? This crazy woman who went out and lived with chimpanzees in the forest by herself, I want to see her. So that gets you in at the door. Yes?
The RZSS have just held a wonderful three-day conference that just ended a few hours ago before you came in here on environmental enrichment, so how we can improve the welfare of animals in captivity. So can you let us know your thoughts on how you think that we can improve the welfare of animals in captivity? Clearly we're sitting in a world-class chimpanzee facility, but where do you see sort of welfare going for captive animals within zoological collections?
Back in 1960, back in 1962, when I got back from Gombe, I had worked at the London Zoo before I went, and there were just two chimps in this bear cage, and I kept thinking about them while I was out in the forest, and thinking, what can we do to improve their lives? And I designed a little box with holes in the top. It could be cement bolted to the floor or to the railings, and the chimps would poke in for a food reward. It was not used because the keeper said it was too much work to fill it up. So what I've seen over the years, because I went on, the first zoo to use one of my designs was the Bronx Zoo. And that I designed for the chimps. And it was just a board, which is about that thick, and with holes like this into which you put a grape or something. And that was made to mimic the palm tree, the oil palm, which the chimpanzee pokes the nuts out with his finger or her finger. And the chimp keeper didn't want to use it. No, they don't have chimps there, that's right. But the orangutan keeper wanted to use it. And the orangutan would be given this board with grapes and his dinner. And he would ignore the dinner because they want to use their brains. So the more things like Andy's, I mean, Andy says some people are worried because they see a monkey sitting in a small cage and they think it's imprisoned and cruel. But the monkey's choosing to be there and do it because they like to use their brains, just like us. They're bored. So we have, and we are reviving, a program called Chimpanzoo, which could be for any kind of animal. And it was actually every year in America we had a Chimpanzoo conference, and one of the main attractions of it was all the different people bringing their poster boards of all their enrichment activities. And so it's as people get to know more about different animals and are allowed to use their ingenuity and their, you know, their empathy, so the zoo management is by and large getting more receptive. The keepers are now educated and care about the animals. And so it's changed a lot, and it can change more for more different animals as we learn more about them. And the zoo allow, even in really, really bad zoos, we have a wonderful keeper from the Phoenix Zoo. And we scrounge up money for her to go to places like Egypt and really dangerous places, where there are chimps that we've been hurt, we've been told about chimps in bad conditions. And she goes and works with the zoo, with the keepers. She's done magic. She's introduced chimps who've been alone for, you know, for years and years and years. And we're now seeking to employ her full time because she wants not to do what she's doing at the zoo. She wants to help all these chimps around the world. So as we get more people working on different animals, with enrichment, things will get better and better. But some animals shouldn't have dolphins and killer whales in aquariums. It's not right. And these beluga whales, it was just turned down, luckily. So, anyway.
I think we have time for one more. Judy.
To put this on a practical basis, what three things would you encourage each of us to do or not do each day to help some of what you've been talking about tonight and to give us an agenda and some action points to take away from this?
All right, one is to try and get Roots and Shoots going, wherever you know a child or a teacher or a parent, to learn about it. We have a fantastic website now. It's a new one, rootsandshoots.org, and to get involved with that, to help children, to empower children. That's one thing. I have to say that joining our institute would help us to do what we do, because, you know, you can't keep going unless you have the funding. But the most important of all is different from those things. The most important of all is to think about the consequences of what you choose each day. If you do that, you see, I don't know all of you. I don't know how you live. I don't know what to say you should do. But if you just start thinking, you know, where did this food come from? How many food miles has it traveled? Did it result in lots of damage to the environment with lots of pesticides? Did it come from some far off place which meant the cutting down of the rainforest? This clothing, was it made with child slave labor or in sweatshops? How do I get to work? What happens if I see a hurt animal or a sad person? Do I go away leaving the person happier or sadder? Those sort of things. And that's for each one of us. And I can tell you that it works, and sometimes spectacularly so. I had one man, and he came to my lecture, and we had a bit of a talk, and he was wealthy. And then I didn't hear about him for 2 years, and I thought, oh, well, you know. And then he wrote to me and he said, well, I went away and I thought and I thought, and I realized my house was much too big, using much too much energy, and I sold it. I've now got a little one and I'm happier. And another one was one of our board members in Holland happens to love sports cars, and he'd always wanted a sports Ferrari. And he came to this board meeting and he was actually planning to test drive it the following day. And I talked about this, well, there's a long story, we don't have time for it. But anyway, basically the same sort of thing. And when he's going back and is to drive his car the next day, he thinks, damn Jane. He doesn't buy the car and he gives us the money. So those are the kind of things that can happen. And they're quite remarkable, actually. And it just shows if you can get into people's hearts that there is change. But you've got to find a way of getting into the heart. And not embarrassing. I found at one time I was embarrassing wealthy people in the audience because I was talking about, you know, our unsustainable lifestyle and people who've got two houses and two cars and this, that and the other, and they were all just curling up. So I always say now, some people are really good at making money, or they happen to be lucky enough to have inherited money, and it's fine to have lots of money as long as you use it to change the world and make it better. So.
Okay. On that note, I would like to say thank you so much for being our inaugural tribal elder. That was a marvelous and inspiring speech. And before you let go of your stick, we have
my
baton. Two thank yous for you. First, I think it might appeal to you. I'll carry it home for you.
That's beautiful. That'll be a lovely home for Mr. H and Cow.
Well, and I would like to say before I bring it out of the bag, this is something unique to the RZSS because it was created especially for you by our very own blacksmith, J.R. Ramsey, who is sitting in the second row here. J.R., could you just please stand up for me? Excellent care with the rest of the team of our facilities here. You will see that he's also an artist.
Oh, how fantastic. Oh. That is beautiful.
So, this is your rhino.
I'm going to call, is it a male or a female? What do you think?
It's a female because people tried to make it a male when I was away one day.
And the bits fell off, did they? Well, I'm going to call her Mechie because Mechie is so special.
Vocal thank you. Where's Graham? Graham, where are you? Thank you. Would you like to
lead off, please? I'm not kidding.
Sophie, come on.
Perhaps to approach it a different way. Yeah, when you were at St. Andrews, one of the moments in that ceremony was where you said, this ancient hall has never heard the voice of
But
our
is, it tra- is it soundproof?
I think we can do.
Without waking them up.
Sophie? Is it okay, Sophie?
I didn't want to wake them up.
I think they're one of the other calls, as long as we're not too loud.
So if you would like to speak to us in the language of our closest living relative, that would be wonderful.
All right, well, I have to do it very quietly because of the real closest living relative behind us.
Yes.
Okay, so it's the greeting call. Why was my voice, you see? Didn't get the whiskey.
Just a whisper.
Yes. And your last duty here tonight is to... I know you probably reluctantly going to have this on.
Well, I hardly had it.
I know that. Well, you might just be allowed to have it for a little while longer tonight, but you do need to do a formal official handover because we are also extremely fortunate to have in our audience tonight Professor Aubrey Manning. Aubrey, would you like to come join us in here? Now, as many of you will know, Aubrey is a zoologist, behavioralist, broadcaster, and Aubrey is going to be our next tribal elder speaker on the 23rd of October, talking to us about population. And I'm just going to leave it at that. But I'm going to step out of the way so that you may receive the baton.
Okay, well, I am commissioned to challenge you. And I have the baton, so I can do it. I haven't handed it over yet. So while I have control of the baton, I'm challenging you to use that position to tell lots of stories, to get into people's hearts, and to help them understand, not here, but here, why we have to make this change. And what they can do to make a difference. So I feel that I'm handing it over to very special come take a good photo. Come on. Well, we've both got it.
And we will have an opportunity for some photos outside for a few minutes. Jane, as you know, is her books are available for sale, and she will be happy to sign for you. And I also wanted to mention that we will have, what's the phrase, a different phrase? We will have baskets for anybody who'd like to.
A retiring collection.
Thank you. For Jane Goodall Institute. So I'd be grateful if you could provide a little bit of help in one of the baskets on your way to the book signing. And Aubrey does the same thing.
May I just say that you won't be surprised that the old cliche, a hard act to follow, is uppermost in my mind. But Jane, I can assure you that so many things which you have spoken of tonight will kick off ideas in all of us. They certainly kick off ideas in me. And two people whom I love to quote, one is Edmund Burke, and how well you've illustrated that maverick old Irish politician. He never was in greater error than he who did nothing, because he felt he could do only a little. There's that. And then there's that saying which Plato ascribed to Socrates, without love there is no wisdom, only learning. And boy, do we need wisdom. Yeah. And you have exemplified that so marvellously tonight. It's with great humility I pick up the baton, and we will try. I certainly will qualify on the elder. The wisdom remains to be seen.
Well, you've already demonstrated the wisdom, so that's fine.